got your ticket, that means you're going places, or does it? Not necessarily.
Well, we've used tickets tonight to discover two unspoilt European destinations and bring you one of the classic holiday adventures. San Francisco's Golden Gate Bridge is the opening sequence to any spot of Californian dreaming.
Cephalonian dreaming is a whole different experience. In the same group of islands as Corfu, Cephalonia has remained almost untouched by tourism. That's even despite the fact that, unlike many other Greek islands, it's very easy to reach by direct flights. The island is stunningly tranquil, but for how long? We sent Lorraine Chase to test the peace.
The last time I went to Greece was a good few years ago. My lasting memories of it are veg and tomato sauce, grazed knees from a dodgy scooter, and the distinct impression that a lot of the buildings weren't quite finished. But then I hadn't found Fiscardo. I have now. The holiday is in two parts. The first week is great for winding down, sitting back and enjoying the fact that everyone else is doing the sailing. I'm a great believer in the early postcard home. Well, otherwise you don't do it, do you?
You know, it ain't half bad here. The people are exceptionally warm, but, well, perhaps I should reserve my judgment. The whole scenery is very gentle on the eye. Secretly, I think I love it. But let's see. With love now as always, Lorraine.
But you can't sit around long vegetating, so I hired a boat with engine for 140 sobs a week and poodled off to one of the fabulous little bays. I tell you, if I can handle these boats, you certainly can. Now diving. I'm not too bad at the artistic impression, but my technical merit's a bit dodgy.
Well, it is nice, isn't it? Ooh.
After a luxurious dip, time for a bit of culture.
Oi, oi. Now, those scholars amongst you will know that 3,000 years ago, Homer wrote the book, The Odyssey. Now, it heavily featured a geezer called Ulysses and his old lady Penelope. Now, Ulysses took 10 years to wander home after the Trojan Wars. But between you and me, I think he stopped off on one of the islands with a nymph called Calypso. I don't know. The excuses you blokes use when you're late home. Anyway, less of that. This is where he was making home too. The most famous, yet least known of all the Ionian islands, Ithaca. Spend the second week of your holiday in the little town of Phrixus here on Ithaca. Windsurfing, foof! I thought I'd throw myself in at the deep end.
I'll just show you how to hook in.
Right.
Okay, put that on the hook. Take the strain with the black knob so the wire actually takes the strain.
Ooh.
Straight front push against the shroud.
Yeah.
That's it. And straight
hopefully
down.
Drop the chicken wire.
You drop the chicken wire because you won't need that.
Won't need that.
Okay, and away you go.
This part of the holiday is for the experienced sailor or the quick learner. Personally, I've never sailed before in my life. The instructors are wonderful, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. I've perfected it. Woo. Even the experts fall in, you know.
Oh, you could have seen it. It was wonderful. We did it with great style. Oh.
You want to try writing the blooming thing?
No worries.
I'm a Sarah running.
enjoyed myself today. Went out on the Hobie Cap for the first time with a well-formed Aussie lad. Don't think I've quite got the hang of it. Learned all about Homer's Odyssey. All this art and literature could ruin my career. With lots of love now, as always, Lorraine. Have you ever been boating underground? Come on, I'll show you. This is Melisani Lake. It was discovered when the roof caved in. Here, you can imagine their surprise when they clocked this lot. The water is reputed to have come all the way from Argostoli, the capital, via underground streams. Amazing when you think, isn't it? Now that he's stopped singing, a bit of hearsay. A chance archaeological find brought to light a clay figure of Pan surrounded by dancing nymphs. Oh my God, here he goes again. An impressive statue of a young woman was also found, thought to be the nymph Melissa, after whom the chasm is named. No Pavarotti, is he?
Oi, oi, all right?
Hello, Lorraine. We're off to the shops.
Enjoy yourselves.
These are the waterfront apartments where I stayed for my brief visit. That's my boat, that flash one on the right. No problem parking, and very useful it was too. Inside, the apartments are excellent. Evening.
Where?
The maid. You know, these apartments are so well equipped.
Lovely fruit. Oven.
All the utensils. But between you and me, we'll go to the taverna. It's so cheap.
Beer 50p, bread 40p, chips 40p. In fact, supper £4, including wine. And of course, more singing. That memory I had of veg and tomato sauce all those years ago. I must have been going to the wrong restaurants. Well, I was a model. Cheapskate photographers. Here, cop this lot. How would I sum it all up?
Utopia. With love, now, as always, Lorraine.
Core. A week in those self-catering apartments in Cephalonia cost £244 per person, based on six sharing. A further week learning to sail and windsurf on the island of Ithaca cost an extra £155. That's for accommodation in village rooms and includes all tuition. It's a direct sell holiday company. More details from Greek Islands Club, 66 High Street, Walton-on-Thames, Surrey, KT12, 1BU. And don't forget our information line, 0898 33 55 99, with details of all our holidays.
Now, Lorraine's isn't the only familiar face who'll be popping up from unfamiliar places. We've decided to eavesdrop on the type of breaks the stars take. So over the next few weeks, you'll be getting the chance to see the EastEnders who became Holiday 90 Weekenders.
Ooh, blast the calories.
Gretchen Franklin's stately home trip isn't with Weight Watchers. Pat, who away from the Vic is Pam St. Clement, goes walkabout in the Cotswolds with her friends, who are called Lulu of Lochinvar and Busy Breeches McNasher.
Arthur,
Bill Treacher, of course, is with daughter Sophie and the rest of the family, proving that all Norfolk sailors are broad-minded.
Lovely.
Away from Albert Square, Philip Schofield goes live, but very tentatively, in the French Alps.
We've definitely got a communications problem here.
Robert Robinson, well, he's lost for words about the sunny Scottish Isles. And Skippy's totally speechless when he meets Derek Nimmo on a stroll down Ramsay Street. And that neighbourly adventure to the Land of Oz is next week. Australia has many parallels with our next destination, gold, then surfboards, and now wine.
But there's one area where Australia can't compete. California has probably contributed more lines and titles to the songbooks than the whole of the Antipodes put together. But I wasn't prepared to leave anything in San Francisco. It was my starting point for a 1,000-mile fly drive which took in America's deepest lake, happiest gamblers, meanest cowboys, and biggest trees. First of all, however, I exchanged my roof rack for a wine rack. The grape pickers are Mexican, but the Spanish planted the first Napa Valley vineyard. Today, California makes great wine, though you wouldn't guess it from the stuff they give you at the tastings.
Well, maybe in a year or two, I think I'll stick to the root beer.
It's September when they crush the grapes here, but there's no crush on the roads, and a fly drive package via San Francisco is a ticket to ride into some of the handsomest scenery the state has to offer.
Oh, I can tell we're getting higher and higher here. My ears are popping. This is really gorgeous country.
And it's the way I like to travel. Freewheeling with a good map, exploring places like Lake Tahoe, where the beaches are really packed this time of year, and the water's clear as crystal. Lake Tahoe is a ski resort in winter, but if you think this is a cable car, you'd be wrong. It's the Heavenly Valley Tram.
This is not exactly what you'd expect from California, is it?
I mean, where are the palm trees?
Well, as the Americans themselves might say, this is really awesome.
They'll also tell you Lake Tahoe is the largest, deepest, oldest, and most beautiful lake in America. They could be right. Go for gold is the message in Reno, a kind of look-alike Las Vegas where you can gamble the night away and the day as well until your credit card melts. Gambling's illegal in California, of course, but we've just crossed the border into Nevada and I'm chasing a one-armed bandit.
Win some, lose some.
I'm not going to leave my money to the kids. I'm spending it all. I love it.
There are three things to do in Reno: gamble, get divorced, and get married. In the quickie wedding parlors, it's the thought that counts, even if the flowers and the hearts are plastic.
Okay, your total is $79. Dollars and change.
Thank you.
This is the original copy of your marriage certificate. If you need certified copies, just follow the instructions right here in the back. And there are just some souvenirs in there for you. And you guys are all set. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Oh, well, there are some things you can't do on your own in Reno.
Next stop, Virginia City, a one-street Wild West town where everything's been carefully preserved, even the old funeral wagon.
I hope there's more than one way to leave this place.
It's the kind of place you can get a root beer. You can get your name in the paper, too.
Where
bartender, get this lady a drink.
Come right up.
So people are very friendly around here. Thank you very much.
Where are you from, ma'am?
From London.
London?
Yeah, all the way from London. So tell me, why does this place get the name of the Bucket of Blood Saloon?
Because they have an awful lot of shootings.
Seems logical. So are these. Vouchers for your overnight stops. A family of four could share a room like this with its two double beds for around £60. You buy the vouchers before you go, but even if you're staying in quite modest motels like this, you could find yourself paying a hefty supplement, so budget for it. No eateries at most motels, so you do as the Americans do, go out for breakfast and the morning paper. Too much to read, followed by too much to eat.
These diners are really great. I mean, I've got a huge breakfast here for just $5.35, which is just about £3.50, I think. Please. And you can get all the coffee you want to drink for no extra charge. And I'd reckon you could get three good meals a day sticking to these places for about £15.
Once the summer home of the Awanichi Indians, the magical Yosemite Valley, in one of the great national parks of America. It was carved out during the Ice Age. From Glacier Point, you gaze at rocks rising sheer from the valley floor to the height of Ben Nevis. The fit and fearless scale these walls of granite. Fools rush in.
Yes, I've drawn the short straw, and they think I'm going to climb up that.
Straight up each time.
Okay. I feel like a cat on a hot tin roof. I'll just keep going like this.
Look at your feet and watch where you put them.
Yeah, I am. Don't worry, you don't need to tell me.
Here's one I climbed earlier.
It's been a long day.
I was so tired, I drove into a tree. One of the famous giant redwoods, the oldest living things on Earth. San Francisco, here I come, right back where I started from. And what a way to arrive, slamming across the Golden Gate at rush hour. Now, this is a cable car.
I've always wanted to hang on. Here goes. Whee! What a view.
Hey, watch the left side here. Keep it in.
The whole city's like a roller coaster, but the fairground atmosphere around Pier 39 is something else. It's touristy, but it's great fun.
Can I have a pretzel, please?
Yeah, one.
Thanks. Yeah. You've got to try everything.
Take a 1-hour tour all around San Francisco.
Fisherman's Wharf is the place to eat fish. And where you catch the boat for Alcatraz, the city's most sinister landmark. And in the custody of ex-prison guard Frank Heaney, I get an escorted visit.
I think what horrifies me most is the total lack of privacy.
Exactly, yeah. And these men remain in here 24 hours a day. We wash them all the time.
It was one of the harshest penitentiaries America ever knew, and the setting for two famous films, Escape from Alcatraz and The Birdman of Alcatraz, a true story.
So you actually knew the Birdman?
Yes, I did. I knew Robert Stroud. This was his cell. He had a desk in this corner. And did a lot of writing. I remember coming in and talking to him, and he was a very interesting man. He had 134 IQ with only a third grade education.
If you come to San Francisco.
San Francisco, the place to escape to, not from. That two-week fly drive was with Unijet. Based on two people sharing, it cost from £505 per person. 13 nights accommodation vouchers cost an additional £189. The price includes scheduled return airfares, a hire car and all insurance.
So you've got everything you need. Money, passport, ticket. You're almost there. Or are you?
Surprisingly, an airline ticket, no matter how much you pay for it, doesn't guarantee you a seat on the plane. Airlines overbook on purpose. They say they have to remain economical. They simply can't afford to fly with empty seats. So they sell more tickets than there are seats, because they know from experience that some passengers won't turn up.
But what happens if they all turn up? Well, it's first come, first served. Once all the seats are full, you can be, as they say, bumped off the flight. The airlines are only obliged to transport you, as they point out in the small print, with reasonable dispatch.
But what happens if you are bumped and stranded at an airport? Are you entitled to compensation? And if so, how do you go about claiming it?
Well, according to a spokesman for the airlines organisation, IATA, we are now entering a grey but interesting area that varies from country to country and from area to area. Yes, very interesting, as long as you're not the one who's been bumped.
On internal flights within the United States or flying out of the States, you're entitled by law to claim up to $400 if you don't get away that day. In Spain, too, compensation is law by royal decree, even. However, in the rest of Western Europe, there's an informal gentleman's agreement, but that is all. And in the rest of the world, it just depends on how responsible the airline is.
Airlines aren't very keen on discussing the issue, and the amount paid out is extremely variable.
Air Europe will pay between £20 and £70.
Danair pay a maximum of £100.
Air France pay 50% of the applicable single fare.
Lufthansa pay between £20 and £200.
British Airways pay between £50 and £220.
And a TWA spokesman said, the figure varies, and added, as far as I know, the system is that you don't give a passenger $100 if you don't have to. Not only do the amounts vary, but also how the airline treats you. With some airlines, the onus is on you to claim. None of the airlines we spoke to want compulsory compensation.
So, until the law changes in favour of the passenger, our advice to you, if you're bumped, is don't leave the check-in desk until you've been given a new flight number, demand a compensation form, and perhaps best of all, avoid the whole trauma by checking in early.
But the good news is that the EEC Transport Division agrees with us and is drawing up a legally binding system of compensation. So perhaps by the time Holiday 91 comes around, we just might have the same rights flying from London to New York as we presently have flying New York to London.
Question. If San Francisco is the place to leave your heart, where would you take a broken one? Paris for the weekend? No, that's for two hearts which are anything but broken. The city of broken hearts is Lisbon, the capital of Portugal. For there, women sing fado, songs of loved ones going to war and never returning. Kathy Taylor went with a decidedly light heart.
Portugal. Not the beaches, the golf, the commercial holiday complexes of the south coast Algarve, but the colour and variety of its capital, Lisbon. In the oldest part of the city, Alfama, the tiled roofs nearly rub shoulders. Your only way around is on foot. The trams will take you almost anywhere else. They're lovely, nostalgic, but rickety and slow. If you've £12 to spare, a four-hour coach tour will whiz you around in comfort.
Well, we are passing now, on your right-hand side, Sintra Railway Station. This is a beautiful building built last century in Neo-Manuelian style.
But no, it's not a soft option. Your feet might take it easy, but you have to concentrate.
Now, let's see. Yes, the Monastery of St. Geronimo, 15th century, built in honour of explorer Vasco da Gama, financed by taxes on the spices he brought from India. The monks of the Order of St. Jerome once trod here.
I tell you to go round, to see everything, because this is really a nice place to. There is a very huge room on that side, on that big corridor.
It's not all a history lesson. Some stops are just quick photo calls. The Ritz, you'd recognise it anywhere. It could be anywhere. Luxurious five-star comforts, but rather clinical and characterless. Not so the view from the Mundial Hotel. It's £30 a night cheaper, if a little noisier. It's right in the heart of the city. The Rossio, or Central Square, once rang to the cries of witch burning, and they staged bullfights here in the Middle Ages. But nowadays, with its fountains and flowers, it's the place to go just to stroll about and savour the atmosphere. Don't keep on the go all the time. One of the best things about a city in the sun is stopping at a pavement cafe and watching life walk past you.
Mm. Another in this city is the pastries. This is a Belem cake, a local speciality. It was being made to a secret recipe even before my friend here was born.
The specialities aren't all local, though. They steal some ideas. Lisbon is a city of hills, but you don't have to climb them all. Towering 100 feet above the busy shopping streets is a curious construction designed by Monsieur Eiffel after he built the tower in Paris. It's a lift. And at the top, the beautiful 14th century Church of Carmo. The roof didn't survive an earthquake in 1755. It was never rebuilt, as a memorial to the congregation who perished inside. Here's another easy way up a hill. Take the funicular up to the terrace for dinner with a view. The food stores remind you the city lies on the mouth of a river flowing into the Atlantic. They're full of cheap, fresh fish. They're cooked in the simplest and best way, and sardines and sangria will set you back less than £3 a head.
Portuguese majorito. Is the quadra here? Is the nome? O nome?
Portuguese.
Is the Portuguese o nome?
What does it say in English?
Yes, in England. I don't speak English.
I don't speak Portuguese.
Portuguese. The majorito here.
Smells lovely.
Yes.
It's a little love poem, is it there? Like a fortune cookie or something?
Yes.
Yeah. These fragrant fortune-telling plants are traditional, as is the local fado music. These medieval songs are all about longing, regret and nostalgia. You'll probably feel like singing one when you have to leave this charming city.
And if a bit of nostalgia's up your street, a long weekend at the Mundial Hotel would cost from £209 per person. That includes scheduled flights from Gatwick and 3 nights bed and breakfast. If you fly from Manchester, you get an extra day, but it costs £269. They're from the Travel Scene Short Break Cities brochure, which is nearly everything from Rome to Reykjavik.
Next week, Derek Nimmo meets our Aussie neighbours, Kathy goes golfing.
And I make my Holiday 90 film debut.
Ta-da.
In the January sun of Suffolk.
So join us and we'll bring some sunshine into your living rooms. See you then.
Bye-bye.